Hello everybody, I'm Dr Renée and I'm back for my weekly vlog, so thank you for joining me. So today I'm going to talk about hypothyroidism, which is an underactive thyroid. It's a big problem, lots of people suffer, and I need to declare at the very start of this video that I have a vested interest in this particular topic because I lost my thyroid to a very nasty lump about 17 years ago, and across that time I have built up lots of experience, done lots of research, and been through the mill. So some of this video is going to be geared towards what I've experienced, and some of that is controversial. So if you don't like controversial, turn away now. If you do, keep watching. So what is the thyroid? The thyroid is a gland that produces hormones. It sits here at the front of the neck, in front of the windpipe. It's butterfly shaped, so it has two lobes either side of the windpipe, and it's a really important gland, and I'll explain why just now. It produces hormones, two of them in the main. There are some others, but the main ones are thyroxine, or T4, and this is the less active of the two main hormones it produces, and then T3, which is triiodothyronine, and that's the more active. So what do the hormones do? Well, essentially, once you get down to every single cell level in your body, thyroxine, in its active form, T3, controls the metabolism of all cells. So that means it controls how fast your nails grow, your hair grows, your heart beats, your brain functions and your ability to think, your skin grows, your bowels work, basically everything. So you can consider your thyroid gland to be the engine or motor of your body. That's why it's so important, because when it goes wrong, when it acts too quickly or too slowly, the symptoms can be awful and at points life-threatening. So as I said, I'm going to talk today about an underactive thyroid, and the thyroid can go wrong in two ways. It can work too quickly, and this is called hyperthyroidism. And it can work too slowly, and this is called hypothyroidism, or underactive thyroid. The majority of patients we see as GPs have an underactive thyroid. That's the most common scenario, and it happens for many, many reasons. So who gets thyroid issues? So it's definitely a woman's problem. I'm one of them. One in 50 women have a thyroid problem, so it's big. And 1 in 1,000 men, not so big. And it increases with age, whether you're a man or a woman. So what are the causes of an underactive thyroid? Well, they're vast, and lots of them are actually a vlog in their own right. So I won't go into the whys and wherefores, but I will tell you what they are. So sometimes in an autoimmune condition called Hashimoto's, the thyroid actually gets attacked within the body and starts to be destroyed, and therefore stops working, or gradually stops working. Sometimes it's genetic, so you can be born without a thyroid. That's a medical emergency, and that's why babies have the heel prick test when they're born, to test their thyroid. It can be as a result of pituitary failure. Now, pituitary failure is a gland in the brain that sends out a hormone called thyroid stimulating hormone to the thyroid to tell it how quickly or slowly to work, how much thyroid hormone to make. If that doesn't work properly, then the thyroid won't work properly. Sometimes when people's thyroid becomes overactive, we have to treat it to try and get it back to normal. And we do that through surgery, through medications, and through radioactive iodine. The aim is to get it to normal, but quite often it's a difficult science. You can't get it exactly right, and lots of people end up hypothyroid after that treatment. And now, more controversially, and I did warn you, sometimes people just don't respond very well to T4. They have a resistance to it. So that means it doesn't matter how much medication we give them, they just don't seem to absorb it very well, or use it as they would their own thyroxine. And it happens at cellular level, in every cell in the body, and if people stop doing that, and that's what happened to me, and I'll talk about it later, then they become quite sick. It's controversial because it's not recognised universally within the medical arena that this actually happens. So what are the symptoms of hypothyroidism? Well, they are absolutely vast, and before I list some of them, and I couldn't possibly list all of them, it's important to recognise that lots of these symptoms can be caused by lots of other conditions. So just because it is a sign of hypothyroidism doesn't mean that's what the cause is. And that's why it sometimes takes a GP time to unpick what's really going on. But to give you just a few, or quite a few. So if your thyroid isn't working so well, you'll be putting on weight, but actually have no appetite and not be eating much. You could be cold all the time when other people are hot. You'll be sleeping, oversleeping, but still not feeling refreshed. Your periods could become different to how they normally are. So they'll become heavier and closer together. And that was always the first sign for me that my thyroid medication wasn't quite right. It can cause infertility, so a massive issue. It can cause dizziness and breathlessness. It can actually cause loss of libido or sex drive, muscle or joint pain, hoarseness, dry or gritty eyes, hair loss, particularly to the eyebrows and the outer part of the eyebrow. That's quite a classic sign of hypothyroidism. Difficulty swallowing, constipation, changes in how you're feeling mood-wise. So depression is quite a common sign of hypothyroidism, but is sometimes misdiagnosed, and lots of women are put on antidepressants when actually it's their thyroid which is actually the problem. So as you can see, there are lots and lots of symptoms, and you may get some of these, all of them, one or two, and everybody, as always, is unique. And as I said before, lots of these symptoms can be caused by other things, so it's really important to have proper investigations. So what are those investigations, and how will your GP diagnose hypothyroidism? Well, it's a blood test, and that blood test in the UK, following UK guidelines, generally looks at thyroid stimulating hormone, which is the one I mentioned from the pituitary gland in the brain, and T4, which is the main but less active thyroid hormone. And the reason we look at thyroid stimulating hormone is because if your thyroid stops working so well, your pituitary gland picks that up on a negative feedback pathway, and it starts to produce more TSH to try and stimulate your thyroid to produce more hormone. So the theory goes that if the TSH is raised, it means that your thyroid isn't working so well. So that's an indicator that things are not quite right. If you get your blood test back and your TSH is raised, but your T4 is within the normal blood ranges, that's called subclinical hypothyroidism. And you won't necessarily be treated at that point. You'll be asked to have another blood test in about 6 months. Now, in the UK, if you don't have any symptoms, and that's what your bloods show, we will allow the TSH to go as high as 10 before we treat. Now, for some people, lots of people I would imagine actually, a TSH of 10 could make them feel absolutely awful. A TSH of 4 makes me feel awful. So I think that's a really important thing to know. Just because you're within the range for watch and wait doesn't necessarily mean that's right. And if you've got symptoms, any of those symptoms, you need to go back and have a discussion. If your T4 is low and your TSH is high, that's hypothyroidism and you should be treated. And your GP will manage these results quite well. That's what we do, you know, that's what we're trained to do. But we are trained within these guidelines. A lot of people don't sit within those guidelines, but I'll come on to that. Your GP will manage you or refer you to an endocrinologist. And generally they'll refer you to an endocrinologist if you've had a scan of your thyroid, an ultrasound scan, which shows any lumps or masses, because they'll need to be investigated. If you've just had a child, or if you're pregnant, if you're taking any medications that can affect the thyroid, or if you're a child, you should get referred to an endocrinologist. But otherwise, your GP is perfectly placed to treat you. So, what is the treatment for hypothyroidism in the UK, or around the world? So, you'll be given a synthetic hormone of T4. It's called levothyroxine. And you take it in the morning on an empty stomach with a glass of water, and you shouldn't have any iron or calcium containing supplements with it, and you shouldn't have any caffeine or food for an hour after taking it. Now, I don't know about you, but I need a cup of tea as soon as I step out of bed in the morning. So I have a decaffeinated tea, and you can have a decaffeinated tea or coffee, and that doesn't affect my thyroid levels at all. So that's how I convince my brain that it's getting its cup of tea in the morning. Now, your GP will start slowly, probably start you on 25 micrograms of T4, and then retest your bloods every 4 to 6 weeks. And it's important to start slowly because it can affect your heart and it can cause palpitations or arrhythmias. So that's why we go nice and slowly. And it takes about 4 to 6 weeks for your blood levels to change. So that's why we wait for those blood tests. And for the majority of people, T4 works very, very well indeed. But, and this is where I'm going to become really controversial. So you might want to switch away or you might want to listen. Some patients never feel well on T4 alone. They just never get back to their normal selves. And alongside this, the bloods that their GP are doing for them appear in range. The TSH is in range and the T4 is in range. And they'll be told by their GP that that's fine, but they still don't feel well. Some people, and this is the really controversial bit, don't convert T4 to T3. The UK guidelines tell doctors, and we get taught this at medical school, to only look at the TSH and T4 and not to use anything else, not to make a judgment. But I think we need to make a judgment, and I have lots of experience as to why. There's no routine measurement of T3 in the blood in the UK. Some labs won't even do it. Sometimes my bloods get sent off with a T3 and the lab don't do it, they ignore it. But it is important, and I'm going to take you through why. The reason for these guidelines is that the evidence is equivocal. So there are studies to say that patients are much better on a combination of T4 and T3. There are studies that say it makes no difference, and there are studies that say patients are worse. So because there isn't enough evidence from the studies, the guidelines we have at the moment are as they are. So, T3. Is this the answer for the minority of patients that don't get on with T4 alone? Well, let me tell you my story. I got on fine with T4 for about 6 years. I was absolutely fine. I didn't have any problems. My bloods were in range. My TSH was always very low, always, from the very start. That's how I reacted to synthetic T4. However, I went through a stressful time. I was taking my medical final exams, actually. And I started to feel rubbish. I was sleeping all day, which wasn't good for studying. I was swelling up and bloating. I couldn't think, my mood was poor. Things were not right. I started to see my endocrinologist and she kept increasing my T4. Nothing was changing, just my T4 was going up. So she then did some T3 bloods and my T3 was below range. So even with my increasing T4, my T3 wasn't changing. So fortunately for me, I had an endocrinologist that was quite happy to step outside of the guidelines. And she said to me, you have stopped converting T4 to T3, you need some T3. So she added in some T3, and it's always a much lower dose than T4 because it's much more powerful, about 5 times more powerful. And I take it twice a day, whereas the T4 I take once a day, because it has a much shorter half-life. From that moment, I began to feel well, and within a month I was back to my normal self. Now the result of this in my blood tests was that my T4 and T3 were within the normal ranges. My TSH, however, was below the normal range. It was what we call suppressed. And lots of GPs and other doctors get nervous about that, but my endocrinologist is happy that that's my response. She examines me all of the time and says that I am euthyroid, that means normal thyroid. I don't have any signs of being hyperthyroid. And we've now been on that dose, or I've been on that dose of T3 and T4 for 11 years. And it works beautifully for me. My mood is good, I can think, I'm not swollen, I hope, as you can see. I'm not sleeping all day, and I'm back to my normal self. And there are lots and lots of patients, anecdotally, who feel the same, that they never felt right until they had T3. And so it sounds easy, doesn't it? Just give the patient T3. But it's not that easy. But what I would say is if you're on T4, you're not feeling well, you think you've got symptoms, in the first instance, see your GP. Ask for a T3 blood test, see if they can do it. If more thyroxine is added and you still don't feel well, ask to see an endocrinologist and discuss this T3, T4. There's a lot of information about this on Thyroid UK's website, which is thyroiduk.org.uk, but I will put this up after the video. But there's a vast amount of information and message boards, so it's a really great place for you to actually get more information than I can give in this vlog. So there's a bit of a T3 scandal going on at the moment, because 5 years ago, T3 in the UK was £19 a month, and that's how much it still is in Europe. But unfortunately in the UK, it's now about £260 to £80 a month. And as a result, lots of CCGs, they're the governing bodies that run local GPs, don't want to pay for it, and they're putting it on blacklists. So in some areas of the country now, you can't get T3. I'm fortunate that I'm in an area where I still can, but I am terrified that that will change at any point, and I can't buy it over the counter. And where will I get it? Well, that's the dilemma that many, many people are facing, and they're scared. I'm scared because I know what happens when I don't have it. And it's already happening in some areas of the country. Now also, NHS England is running a consultation soon looking at over-the-counter medicines that either don't work very well or are very cheap. And they've added T3 to the list of 10 drugs that they're looking at, which is odd, because it's not available over the counter and you have to have a prescription for it. They say that it is clinically effective, but there are cheaper alternatives. Well, the cheap alternative is T4, and we know that that doesn't work for a lot of people. So we need to tackle this. We need to speak to NHS England. We need to take part in the consultation, and we need to campaign with the various campaign groups that there are currently looking at this very thing on behalf of their patients. Bear in mind that 1 in 50 women are affected by this. Many cannot function without T3. I certainly am one of them. So £260, £280 a month is expensive, but it would be much more expensive if I wasn't functioning in society, if I couldn't work. I'm a GP. Surely I'm more valuable than £260 a month, as are most women who are working, looking after children, looking after relatives. You know, it's ridiculous that women are being affected in this way, and it is mainly women. So what to do? Well, if it affects you, if it affects a member of your family, someone you love, make an appointment to see your MP. That's what I'm going to do, and talk to them about it. Ask them to raise it for you. You can write to NHS England, to Simon Stevens, who's the chief executive. You can take part in the consultation. You can sign the petition that's currently underway, and I'll put that on here afterwards as well, so you can look it up. And I'll put the information for Thyroid UK and some of the information that I've mentioned in the video, because it's a lot obviously to take in. But it's really important. It's really important to me. I won't be able to make these videos if I don't have T3, because I won't be able to think. Certainly won't be able to write them. So please, if you have a thyroid that you think isn't working very well, just go and be tested. It may be that you just need T4, which works brilliantly for lots of people. If you're already on T4 and you're still not feeling well, go back to your GP and speak to them. And if you're not getting anywhere and you really feel strongly about it, ask to see an endocrinologist and discuss T4, T3 with them. And hopefully this has been really, really helpful. It's not been too much about me. I'm sorry if you think it has, but I think I represent lots of people out there who are suffering like I did. And thank you for watching. And again, post any questions afterwards and suggest any videos for the future. I've got lots of good suggestions, but I'm quite happy to take more. Thank you for your support.